Hello, this is a welcome to the spring 2021 semester. I am Eric Sponza, I will be your professor, and in this first part of the video, we're going to discuss the online nature of the class. So now everyone from all my classes is watching this. All of you have a second part video where we'll get into the individual aspects of each class, going through the syllabus, and then there'll be a third part where we'll talk a little bit more about how we'll go through with testing and submission, and that'll also be lead into our first overall assignment. So, first things first, this is a fully online class, so let's get into the nature of that. Not only is this class online, it is also going to be asynchronous in all of its presentation. So what that means is that there will be no live class sessions. What we will do, I will have all of the class organized. We'll basically use Blackboard as our central information hub, and then through email and basically YouTube videos will be the rest of the class. So that I will make instructional videos, I have them posted on YouTube, I will send you those links, and all of this will be very organized. So let's start at the beginning. So Blackboard. Blackboard, like I said, is going to be your informational hub. Everything that I send to you, every bit of information, can also be accessed through Blackboard. You can get your syllabus, or when we get to the point that we have tests and things like that, maybe some other extra problems, anything else that I give to the class, all of that would be located under course documents. Every homework problem from the book, anything that has to do with homework, all of that will be located under the assignments tab. All the rest of like our videos and notes, those will all be organized under course outline. And then the main tab, the announcements tab, when you open up Blackboard, that's where you'll get pretty much the rest of your information. A lot of that will be test dates, but you know, almost always there'll be some other pieces of information that I'll share through the announcements. So everything can be found under Blackboard, but then on top of that, you can really, really just get through your emails. Because through your email, now, when I send you an email, I use Blackboard to send it, so therefore it goes to your QCC email account. Make sure you're accessing that. If there are any problems, there have been a few little hiccups as Blackboard has been used more with some of the email delivery. So anytime you have any problem, just always send me an email and I could re-forward it. But especially after we get going, this typically works very well. So that on Sundays, sometime on Sunday, I will send you an email with all of the work for the week. Now that email, it's not just going to be a here, do this. It's very much like what you might expect at the beginning of a class, a little bit of what we've done, where we're going, a little bit of the pacing and the schedule. So you definitely want to read that those emails that I send. But in addition to that generic information, you'll get all the specifics. You'll get the links to the YouTube videos for that week, and you'll also get, again, anything else, any other documents will be attached. My class notes, any additional problems, that will be attached inside of the email. All homework problems and things like that will also be listed in the email. So the email is going to be a very, very big information source. You certainly want to be reading that. And then, of course, the YouTube videos. So this video that you're watching right now, obviously this is set up through YouTube, and all the other videos will be as well. All the videos I post under the username QCC Sponza, QCC Queensborough Community College, and then my last name, S-P-O-N-Z-A. So you could always go through YouTube. Now I know a lot of people are pretty familiar with YouTube, have a lot of experience with it. If you're not, don't worry. Okay, I'm going to give you all the direct video links. The only thing is that, especially if through Blackboard, you pretty much always have to copy and paste. It doesn't come up as a nice link that you could just click. You just use the copy and paste feature, and then you can get to the videos and go directly to each individual video for every individual lesson. Now, YouTube, let's just talk about that for a moment. I don't have any overall like extra allegiance or anything to YouTube. It just happens to be a very good, convenient, handy site. Most people, like I said, do have a little extra experience, have used YouTube for something in the past. So just have a little familiarity with it. It's a free site. Anybody can access it. If you have a username, that's great, but you don't need one. You don't have to sign up for anything. Some people like to subscribe to my channel. Again, you don't have to. You could always just follow the individual video links. YouTube is, you know, it's very accessible. What method are you using to watch the videos? You pretty much use whatever you want. People can watch YouTube through their smartphones. People, you know, there are extra special YouTube apps that people can use instead of just accessing through the internet. People watch it through, you know, Fire Stick and other things on their main television. People can do it on their laptops, again, their iPads or tablets. Just again, YouTube just happens to be a very friendly site that it pretty much doesn't matter which smartphone, which computer you have, very easy to access and to use. The other nice little aspect of YouTube is the closed caption feature, the subtitles. Most of the time for people, depending on what you're viewing, the bottom right-hand corner of your video screen, there's a little CC option that you can click. And for some people, it's just a matter of sometimes, you know, how are you watching the videos? You're watching it at home, there's other people around, so maybe you're using your earbuds or you have the volume on low. So maybe it's just another way to help see the words to make sure you're not missing anything. For other students, particularly students where English is their second language, sometimes that really helps out a lot in that, again, being able to see the words just to make sure, did you understand that correctly? Did you catch it? And from what I've seen, YouTube does a very good job of subtitling. Every once in a while, it misunderstands, but even with some of the technology, the different terms that we use for different classes, they really do a good job of transcribing. So like I said, it's not that YouTube is anything spectacular, but it's a very reliable source. You know, now, for most of us now, we've had several semesters of online experience, so hopefully we're starting to get a little more comfortable with it. And again, with maybe you've had different issues with some of your sessions. Sometimes the session crashes or it's inaccessible. Even Blackboard, which is a pretty good site, but Blackboard gets bogged down. That's one reason why I'm starting to load everything on Sundays. Monday seems to be a little bit more of a common day that other people are using it as well. So sometimes it gets a little bit, you know, bogged down, crashes because of that. But YouTube is very reliable. So I think in the last year that we've been doing this, I think there's been about a half an hour where YouTube was inaccessible. But outside of that, again, really, really good source. So that's the nature of this class. You will get videos. Now, most of you, this is going to be one of the rare videos where you see me. Most of the time I'm at my desk, I have a setup so that, you know, I'm writing and you still hear my voice, but that you'll actually just see my hand and that you'll also get the notes to go with that. But that's going to be the main way we organize class. Now, there are advantages, disadvantages that we'll talk about in just one moment, but just to stick with that. So what is class? You get everything on Sunday sometime, and basically I'm just trying to make sure you're ready to go on Monday. Because as we're not going to have live class meetings, you set your own schedule. That's the big part of an asynchronous meeting. And again, from previous semesters, particularly the meeting times for these classes, late afternoon, evening, often have a lot of students who are, you know, they're picking those times because they have a lot of other responsibilities, whether it's, you know, their job, whether it's helping out with like siblings or kids with school, but whatever it is that you're choosing this because it's convenient for your schedule, and maybe you still want to use those times, but I'm trying to give you the freedom so that you can work on your own time. Now, again, we'll also talk a little bit more about how much time, how you should schedule yourself, but just to realize that's the main goal. You get all that information on Sunday night, again, so that it's accessible first thing Monday morning, Monday afternoon, or maybe Tuesday is your work day, or whatever it is, so that when you're ready for the week, you can go access the materials. What is class? Well, again, it's all aspects. I expect you to watch all of the instructional videos. I really have worked hard to make those instructional videos almost identical, again, with little modifications to make it work, but basically what you would expect and how a regular classroom situation would go. So definitely want you to watch those videos in the same way if we were in person, I would be talking about how important it is that you attend class. That's the first and foremost thing. But the second part, again, reading my emails. The third part, using your book, okay? When it comes to using your textbook, well, all your homework problems will be there. And in the individual videos, when we talk about syllabus, we'll talk a little bit more about how your book can be useful. but you really should be at a point that the book is somehow a supplement to your study. For some people, reading over the section in a book, maybe it's just a little casual flipping through, highlighting what are some of the problems, the directions, any new key words that are being introduced, things like that. But for some people, they like to do it beforehand in a class. They kind of use their book to kind of get them warmed up, so to speak. And then the video or the regular class session, that's where they should really be seeing how everything comes together. But for other students, it's the reverse. They really want to start off with the class sessions. Let me introduce the topics, see it all through me first, and then the book provides a little bit more of a supplement to your study. But there is something extra from the book, and it's not just doing your homework problems. For a lot of students coming out of high school, that's study for a math class. You do your homework, that's your study. And I want to point out there's more to it than just that. Of course, doing homework problems, getting the extra practice, that's going to be an integral part in any math class so that you have the right experience. Because that's a huge part for a lot of students in math. They understand it in class. While we're doing it together, while I'm going through a problem, they could really nod and follow along. But, you know, when it comes test time, you have to be able to do it. And the homework is really, really a key step in making sure you're at that ability. And if you're not, that you can identify what it is that you're missing. That you're missing a big major concept and that's causing you trouble. You're misunderstanding the purpose of the directions of what you're trying to do. Or maybe it's just something like you're making a little mistake. I mean, in any of the math classes, there's always this cumulative process in math. So even though we're starting in a fresh, clean math class, there's definitely always some background. Maybe you forgot, maybe you're making a calculator mistake or an algebra mistake. But homework is where you're gonna get that practice. But it's not just the homework. I say this a lot, especially if we are in person, frequency versus duration. I think in all of your classes, getting back the frequency, how often you get back and look over your notes, remind yourself of what the topics are, what the big picture, what are the main concepts. The more often you do that, that's a very good memory technique to help, you know, keep you in that moment. Versus duration, you know, a lot of people have that idea, well, I'm just going to sit and do all this in one big chunk. But a lot of us have had enough experience to realize our brains just don't operate efficiently in that way. For a lot of us, whether it's a regular class or it's a study session, 1 to 2 hours is about the most that our brains can handle, and then you're just fatigued. And then if you just keep working, you're not being productive, you're actually working hard, but now you're forgetting things you did in the beginning. So that's why I really think frequency is a very important aspect. So in a math class, you know, maybe we're getting back to more that idea of how do you set your schedule. And I think an ideal way would be scheduling some time to think about the actual class material, going through the videos, going through the book, etc. A separate schedule, a separate time to start looking at some homework problems and use that as a measuring stick. How well did I understand? Am I able to start a problem, get to the end, get a correct answer on my own? Do I have to flip back to my notes? Do I have to flip back and use a video? So there's a lot of little things to keep track of, but that's like a measuring stick and say, okay, I did well, I'm ready to move on. Or to say, well, I got some of it, but I could use a little more practice. I could go through the video a secondary time. And then another session where it's just the reminder. You're not even doing any fresh problems, but you're just flipping through your notes, reminding yourself. Especially as I give you this freedom to make your own schedule, some people like the idea of like, well, I'm just gonna get it all done on Monday. It's like, I'm free on Monday, I've got that open, so I'm gonna do the entire week's worth of work that day. But then again, realize that, so that means Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, 7 full days later, you're coming back. And no matter how well you understood that stuff the previous week, you've probably forgotten a real lot. And it's almost like you're starting all over again. But like I said, there's always some cumulative process. There's always some building on something we've done earlier in all math classes. And you kind of miss out on that. So that's a big part. Like I said, make sure as you're going through, think about that with your scheduling. Think about that with your study. So, again, what is class? You get your work for the week, you make your schedule, and that throughout the week, you're watching all the videos, you've read any emails. I send you the big email at the beginning of the week, but as we move along, there often are questions. You email me any questions you have, little difficulties that you're having, you want maybe some extra explanation, things that are maybe hanging you up. If you're having problems with any of the homework or any of the examples, we can talk about that. Sometimes I write up a little bit of a longer explanation. If multiple people are having some of the same issues, I definitely try and share that with all of the class. So, you know, you will often get some extra emails from me throughout the week. So it doesn't matter if you catch them a little bit later, but you also want to be reading those as well. So all of that is class. That's what I expect you to be doing. That's your main resource. Now, outside of that, we have other resources as well, but that's the big thing. Get your emails, read them over, watch all the videos, complete all the homework, and think about, you know, a regular study habits, regular patterns and habits of study. I bring that part up. CUNY has already announced that in the fall, they're looking to return and have a regular in-person semester. So a lot of us, as we've been going through this online process, we've had to adjust our habits to make ourselves better equipped to dealing with the online environment. And for some of us, those have been pretty drastic changes. But you also want to make sure you're not losing your in-person abilities. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. But I think this is a good semester to try and find that combination and blend both aspects together. So that way, again, you do well this semester, you still are, you know, taking advantage of what you learned about yourself, how to study and how to prepare and how to do things online, but you're also in a position so that when we're back in person, you haven't forgotten your good regular habits, so that you're sticking with the schedule. Again, you still have set times for study and that you're still studying to take tests like you would in a regular in-person manner. Okay, so a lot about how we're going to operate class. So like I said, Blackboard, your QCC email. When you email me, I don't mind what email account you use, but emails that, again, the main emails that get sent out will go to your QCC email. If you want to set up a forward to one of your other email accounts, that's certainly fine, but make sure you have access to that account. That's where you're going to get a lot of information. Okay, so Blackboard, YouTube, QCC Sponza, for the channel for YouTube, and then again, your email, those three things. Any emails you need to send to me, eSponza, again, you'll get all that information in the syllabus as well, but eSponza@qcc.cuny.edu, that's the email address that you'll contact me. So that's a huge, big part of this video, just what is our online nature. Now, we'll get individual in, again, the syllabi as far as like the testing and your grading components. But first, let's just talk about some of the advantages, disadvantages to having in-person versus being online. In-person, I mean, to be quite honest, I'm always going to prefer an in-person situation. I like being in the classroom with you. For me, getting to know a new group of students, getting to see different personalities, those are always just nice benefits for me, but an overall benefit for the class that in each day-to-day, I could feed off the class's energy. I could see our strengths and weaknesses to make sure as we're moving along, what is the pace? Now, all of them, we've got a lot of work to do in all these classes, so always going to have to make forward progress. But when we're in person, that I could say, you know, we seem like we're having a tough day today, let me slow it down. Or this is really easy, let's move it along, get to the next topic. You know, we can always do those things. We have to, you know, the videos are kind of more that middle of the road. But again, we'll still talk about how we can take advantage of that. But also in person, other people around, okay? Sometimes other people's questions, you don't even realize you had that question. Or sometimes students, they know something's not quite clear, but they can't quite articulate what it is that they're missing. But then having the other students, sometimes that's that little information, somebody else's question may spark. And then people say, ah, that's what I wasn't quite getting. So there are other benefits to having other students around. Of course, that also gives you other people that, you know, if you miss a class, people you could study with, people you can get notes from. So again, there definitely are some other advantages to in-person, But part of my way of structuring this is I want to make sure we're not getting hit with too many disadvantages. I don't want us to see online instruction as a roadblock, as an obstacle. I actually think the way I'm building this, that there are a lot of ways you could take advantage. There are a lot of opportunities, and I hope we can see it this way, because let's go through a few of them. Number one, if we're in person and you do miss a class, or you're just really beat one day, maybe you're a little sick, a little run down, you had a big day at work, or you know, a big project test you were working on, so maybe you're just really beat one day. But as we said at the beginning, for a lot of students, especially in math, that in-person class experience is your main way of learning. So you're showing up to a class, you're exhausted, you're having a new big lesson. A lot of our classes, we meet for some pretty lengthy periods. So maybe you may be sharp at the beginning, but you're a little tired at the end. But whatever the case may be, maybe you missed some of the class. Maybe, again, you were just late. Maybe you actually just missed the entire class entirely. Or maybe just some of the other possibilities that you weren't fully aware. You weren't fully focused and 100% sharp the whole time. Well, now with these videos, that's one of the biggest advantages. You can go back. If you're just really beat one day, you're starting to watch a video and you're getting into it a little bit, but then you're like, I just can't concentrate anymore. I'm done. I'm tired for the day. Pause the video. Go take a break. I mean, maybe it's just you're hungry, you need a little break, you can come back to it later. Maybe it's something where, no, I just need to go to bed and I can come back to it tomorrow. But the videos are there for you. So whether you wanna do, I wanna do this whole video in one day, or I wanna do a couple of videos in one day and then I'll do my homework, you get the freedom to set your schedule. And if your schedule doesn't work perfectly for you, you didn't understand it as well as you wanted, well, as long as you planned ahead, you can always go back. So having those videos, having that accessibility, I mean, in person, we start a new lesson, we work together, I send you home with homework, the next day we come back, we do some review before we build on that and move into a new topic. Well, in the videos, we just kind of get to the next topic. But if you ever need that extra, I'm just a little shaky, go back and watch the video. Sometimes people say in class, like, you know, I kind of followed, but could you do that again? Well, again, now you've got the video, you could go back and watch the whole thing over again. I mean, sometimes it's just going back and watching one particular piece, one particular problem, but that is a huge, huge advantage. The second part, how are you going to be graded? Like I said, we will talk more about that on the syllabus, but just to get right to it, you will have a cumulative final exam. That's a big chunk. The stats people, you guys do have some writing assignments we'll talk about as well. But for everybody else, and even for the stats people, a big chunk of your grade is the in-person grading. I mean, that in person, if we were meeting in a regular class, those would be tests and quizzes. Online, they still are tests and quizzes, but you're taking them from home. And I treat these entirely like take-home exams. I know people still with online setup, they're still trying to set you up. You must take your exam in this window online, but I'm gonna treat these just like take-home exams. I will give your exam before class time of one day, and it will be due. Again, we don't have class Monday, Tuesday, for like it's Monday, Wednesday, or Monday, Thursday. But like the way I would set it up, if your class met at 5 o'clock on Monday, you would get that quiz or test before 5 on Monday. And let's say the class ends at 7 o'clock. It would be 5 to 7 on Monday. Your test or quiz would be due 7 o'clock the next day on Tuesday. So you're getting over 24 hours. Whether it's a half hour quiz, an hour and 20 minute exam, I'm gonna give you that again. It's basically just like a take home. Here it is, you get it, you take it home, the next day you have to turn it in. Now, like I said, how do you turn it in? How do you actually submit? We'll have a whole separate video discussing that. What are the different options? And now that we've done that several semesters, I could pass along a lot of tips, good habits, bad habits, what I expect from you. But just to realize that with that setup, and I'm not gonna collect or grade your homework. I wanna point that out as well. Like I said earlier, your homework is your measuring stick. Should you do it? You better be doing it, because again, that's how you're gonna get good practice. That's how you're going to be ready for your exams. And like I said, that's just good habits, thinking about getting back into in-person habits as well. So that's how you're going to be graded. But now that I've said that, let's just talk about that testing a little bit more. And again, the advantages, disadvantages. Some people just heard what I said. He's not grading homework. I'm going to get over 24 hours for my test. And now, you know, the wheels start turning and they try and think how they could take advantage, and they start getting bad thoughts. They start thinking about, well, they could put this class on the back burner. They'll get the test. They could just kind of watch videos and go through while they take their exam. And it's like they're going to, you know, shortcut this class, so to speak. That's a terrible idea, folks. And like I said, doesn't matter what class you're in, there's cumulative natures to this class, to all these classes. You're going to get in trouble. You may get away with it on a beginning test where, again, it's just, okay, here's the test. I'm just constantly flipping back, looking through my notes, no preparation at all. And again, you may get away with it on a first test, but by the second, and definitely by a third, by a final exam, the work is just not worth it. Okay, it's just really going to cream you, and it's just going to put you in a very, very bad situation. So again, ideally, you're keeping up with the class. You get the test, you have some plan as far as when you're going to take it, and again, it's perfectly fine to give yourself extra time. And again, very rough, if it's a quiz, pretty much any class, a quiz, you get 30 to 45 minutes, depending on exactly how long. And for any test, you'd be getting an hour to an hour and a half. So you could always just say, like, you know, I'm not giving you the exact time frame for each quiz and test, because they're due, like I keep saying, that's the full 24 hours later. If it's maybe if your class is a 3 to 5, you get the test that day at 3, the following day at 5 is when it is due. So all of you are going to have that big window regardless of test or quiz. But ideally, you give yourself that window to take it like a regular exam so that you have prepared. You have studied and done everything you normally would so that you can sit down, take your test and quiz, but now you can take advantage of the online nature to say, oh, okay, I went through. I'm not positive about these couple of questions, so before I submit, let me take advantage. I will go back and either flip through my notes, flip through the book, go rewatch an entire video, or just rewatch a problem to make sure I do it correct. I mean, that's just being smart. That's where I mean, where a lot of people, math is a struggle for them, but even though we're in this online format, there are a lot of ways you could take advantage and end up with a really strong grade for a subject that maybe is not your best. But that's the best way to do it, so that, again, you are prepared, and that you're prepared in a way that you could build on the next, on the follow-up unit, and then be equally prepared for that next test or quiz. And now, you know, what if bad things happen? You feel like you were prepared, but then you go to take the test or quiz, and you realize that on at least half the problems, you still feel a little shaky or uncomfortable. Well, then again, you could still go back, but now you know better. Now you have that sense like, okay, whew, good thing this is online. Good thing I do have that opportunity. If this was in person, I would have been in some trouble. So that's the better habit, okay? And I really hope we're going to take advantage of that. Now, a couple other quick things. Again, we'll talk a lot more about the submission process, but in this online nature and with the freedom I'm giving you, I am very particular about the work that I want to see done. So you have to show me work. Now, how much work? What is enough? Well, if you ever have any questions, that's another place. You could always just send me an email. Ask me your questions. And again, as long as you always are planning, as long as it's not last second, last minute, you'll get an answer in time. So yeah, when you're doing regular study, you hit a little bit of a wall with a topic, you could always email me questions. I check my email multiple times a day, so you may not get an answer in the next 20 minutes, but fairly soon, definitely by the next day, you'll get an answer, and then you could continue and proceed. And same thing, if you're still preparing, hopefully along the way, any of those questions, can I show you, is this enough, they've already been answered. But if something like that comes up on a test or a quiz, as long as it's not due in 10 minutes, you should be able to ask, is this okay? Should I show you a little bit more? that's a perfectly legitimate thing to ask to make sure in this online nature that you are covering yourself. But the honest answer is, if you're watching the videos, I always make that clear in the videos themselves. So you watch the videos, that gives you the sense of what is enough, what is reasonable work. And honestly, there are some problems here and there that there really is very little, if anything, that you could show me, and it is just an answer. But again, in the videos, you would already know, oh, this is one of those problems, there's nothing I could show him, here's my answer, and that's that. But now here's the second thing, everybody. What are your other resources? Okay, you have your emails, you have my videos, but there's a lot of resources that are available. You know, just YouTube. I'm posting all my videos on YouTube. There's things like Khan Academy and many other YouTube sites that, you know, if you know how to look up a topic, you could find a lot of other instructional videos and extra problems. I mean, online, they're everywhere, even just on YouTube, or expand and do a Google search. There's a lot of resources. If you use those outside resources too often, you can get yourself in a little trouble though. Because as we go through these classes, remember, I'm testing you on the material that we are being taught. So it's not always just about getting right answers, it's about demonstrating you understand the material. So if you just try and look up answers online, you may be getting answers that are using tools that we have not discussed. That's where you can get yourself in a little bit of trouble. So again, I'm always very specific in the directions and with the reasonable work to make that clear. And again, if you're just, you know, a little bit of a pinch, you're on a test, there's just still one problem, two problems, you're still a little unsure of course you could try and take advantage of those online resources, those extra resources, but they should not be the first thing you go to. They should be the last thing you go to. What else? What else do you have at your disposal? The Math Learning Center. The Math Learning Center is still open. And as we are doing this asynchronous format where you could always email me, but you don't get that same exact in-person experience, the Math Learning Center, you can. If you let me know you want an appointment, unfortunately, you do have to go through me first. I have to refer you to them, and then they will contact you, and then you can make your appointment, and you can get a live virtual meeting with someone. And I've had a lot of students. I mean, just in general, I have to say, some people are a little hesitant when they first hear about, well, you're just learning through these videos. But I have to say, students overall, the feedback I've been getting has been really, really good. People have really liked the structure, really liked the nature of the videos. So if you're a little hesitant, you know, please give it a chance. And I hope you'll also be pleased. But I also have had some students, they also like the Help Center as like their backup, so that they've got the videos, but they also have someone that they can meet with like once a week, that they could have a few questions lined up. That, you know, again, those little steps, sometimes just the little extra help with the calculator, the little extra help with some algebra, a couple of tough problems from the homework that they want a little extra assistance with. The Help Center is perfect for that. But just like I would say in a regular semester, the Help Center is just that. It's for help. If you're going to the Help Center, you should really have specific problems from the video you want to see with them, specific problems from the homework, specific questions about a topic. They're not teachers. So if you just go to them and say, I don't understand chapter two, you know, they can't help you in that way. That's where you definitely have to talk to me. But for all those other little things, the Help Center could be a great boost. So some of the individual classes, we'll talk about some other resources as well, but that's without a doubt the biggest. You want to be using the videos. You want to be, you know, going through using your textbook. Those are the big ones. And then after that, again, we'll talk about some other little thing. Oh, the Help Center's there if you need it. So there are some other little things to consider as well. But for the tests, like I said, good habits. Prepare like you would in person. But then take advantage of the extra time that you're given, that you can plan ahead, take the quiz, take the test, but then have time to put it aside. I like this 24-hour window for a few purposes. Number one, as I keep saying, there are a lot of students that really need this asynchronous setup so that they can work on their schedule, because there really is, they've got a lot going on. And not only do they have a lot going on, but there's a lot that's changing. People, like, with jobs, with school, with their family, these, you know, it's not quite as fluid as it has been in the past, where people like, okay, my little brother is in school, but then he's at home this day. It's like there's a lot of other things that people are dealing with. So again, I want you to have that window so you could plan ahead. And again, same thing like if we were in person. If you know, like if you knew you had a big business meeting, you're gonna be out of town, something like that, and we have a test that day, you let me know in advance, we'll take care of it. We'll work it out some way. Emergencies happen in that moment. That's definitely a day you gotta get in contact with me to let me know, but we could still work on it. We could deal with it. But you have that window so you could plan and say, okay, he's gonna give me the test Wednesday at this time. Wednesday's booked for me. I better make sure Thursday afternoon I'm gonna get to this test. And that way, again, you don't wanna be doing it right at the last moment in case things come up, in case there's a little hiccup with submission, in case you've got a question that you want to be able to ask before you submit it, so that you give yourself that little bit of time. But so ideally, for some people, we have the luck. I mean, some people, you just have to fit it in where you can, and that's that. But for others, take advantage. Again, if you have not a crazy schedule, that you could say, okay, he gave me the test on Monday, let me do work on it on Monday, and then put it aside. Don't submit it on Monday. Look it over again on Tuesday. Look it over, flip through. If there was a problem you're a little unsure of, try it again. Make sure you get the same answer. Again, take a little time to look something up. I keep saying it, take advantage of this situation so that, you know, maybe instead of doing a good job and getting an 88 because you had a few little mistakes, that you took a little extra time, you looked it over, you caught those little mistakes, and now you get a 97 or something like that. So that's a big part, taking advantage. But the last thing I want to say in this video is the whole idea of, again, making your schedule. All this relies, I mean, in person, I still think there's a very important aspect to keeping to a schedule. But as far as the class times, that by itself forces you. You have to be in class these days on this time. But then outside of class, hopefully you have some thoughts. I'm gonna study on this times. I'm gonna do my homework on these days. And you know, every week to week, it's not gonna be exactly the same. One week, maybe your math class is a little extra busy. The next week, you've got a little bit of a lighter math schedule, but your history class is very busy. So, you know, we have the ability to, the flexibility to tweak our schedule some, but there should be a plan. It shouldn't just be, I go to class these days, and then at some point I randomly think, where am I gonna fit in 5 hours to study for this test? It shouldn't work like that. So that's in person, but now it's even more so. It's even more a bigger test of your keeping to a schedule to make sure that you have that self-responsibility to make sure you're not allowing yourself to fall behind. So how should you make that schedule? Well, again, plenty of us, maybe you just wanna use the regular class schedule. You know, you really want to watch the videos on whatever the times that were scheduled. That works. That's certainly a good start. But then, of course, also thinking about time for homework, time for study. How much time? This is a little bit of a rough ballpark, but again, it still gives you a little bit of a time frame to think about. This is not math. This is all college classes. It's a general idea. For every 1 hour you're in class in person, you should be counting on 1 to 3 hours of outside the class of, you know, study, homework, keeping up, whatever that is. You're reading, reviewing notes, you know, again, doing actual homework problems. That's a general guideline. So the different classes. Trig, you meet 3 hours a week. So that would be an extra 3 to 9 outside for a total of 6 to 12. That's what you should be planning on per week. Stats, you're 4 hours in person per week. So an extra 4 to 12 puts you at 8 to 16 hours for the week. And then calc, you're at 5 hours a week. An extra 5 to 15 puts you at 10 to 20 hours per week. Think about that. That's the type of time frame you should be looking at. A minimum of 8 six, eight, 10 hours, a max. You know, you really want to be thinking about that. Think about yourself. I think so much of college is knowing yourself. You want to expand your knowledge. Sometimes you're seeing some things you've seen before, but then you take it a little further. Sometimes you're learning entirely new topics, entirely new areas. But so much of college, I don't think of it as job preparation, but I think of it as expanding and getting to use your brain the best way possible. Knowing yourself, how do you need to organize yourself? What about your time commitments? All these little things. And when you learn about these things in a college environment, it's so much easier to then apply it in a work environment as well. So you want to get used to that. You want to have a schedule. You want to basically be sticking to it week to week. But of course, as things come up, maybe you do realize, hey, I fell behind on math a little bit this week. So you plan to do a little bit extra next week. That's fine. Again, I'll always give you plenty of notice for tests and quizzes so that you know, oh boy, I better not fall behind because we've got that test coming up. Or to say, okay, well, you know, I really have to focus on this week, as long as I don't let myself fall too far behind, because in any math class, you fall too far behind, you just dig a deeper and deeper hole, and it's really, really tough to climb out of. So plan ahead. Some weeks, maybe, you know, you have that schedule, you finish up early, that's great. Other weeks, you know, it's a little bit busier, you may want to try and plan some extra sessions, but that is a huge part of this. So that's it for this first video. Again, a lot to think about, the overall online nature of the class, getting used to every week, looking over your schedule, reading the emails, getting used to using Blackboard as your resource hub, sending me emails when you have questions. Let me just take one more moment and talk about the sending the emails. Don't hesitate, everybody. You know, again, there's a lot of questions that may come up. Sometimes it's due to the online nature. Ask. There's no shame in asking questions, everybody. Okay? Same thing. Some people, I think a lot of people, as we get a little further along, you get a little more accustomed to me. You kind of have a better sense of what does he expect. But there's still no reason if you're sending several emails per week, one email per week, whether your email is one quick question or you've accumulated a couple of little things you want to ask. I really want you to feel comfortable, everybody, so that no matter what's going on, you want to talk to me. You don't have to. You know, plenty of people go through, they're watching the videos, they're doing their work, and as long as they submit their tests and quizzes, you know, I'm okay with that. You don't have any extra check-ins or any mandatory comments or participation, but I really want you to feel comfortable that when anything comes up, whether it's, again, individual aspects, questions about class, outside of class as well. That's one big thing. I try not to let my videos, while I always in my videos be clear about the reality, how this connects to different aspects of real life, but I also try and make it very clear what you have to be able to do. What are the types of problems? What is it that you're gonna have to show me? But sometimes you just wanna know, what is the reality? How do they really do this? Always, again, feel free to ask. I'm happy to answer those types of questions. And just in general, I want this to be a good, positive experience. I want us to have a good semester, to get a lot out of these classes, but to also make sure we're doing things in a schedule that works for us. Okay, so the next video, we'll start looking at the individual class syllabi.